So I'll start with this. We had three, actually 2.5 days. We listened to keynotes and very informative sessions. So this is the end. So I have to do the closing keynote. Before going there, let's look at what happened during these 2.5 days. So we started with Sanjeeva giving an introduction about the strategy and then about digital transformation, how we are going to link with digital transformation, so on and so forth. Then we had a really good session done by Thomas from West. He explained a model that he following in West to meet the challenges on technical side as well as the people side or the non-technical side, how they are planning to achieve this goal. And then we had the ballerina launch. I think it was a really interesting session. And we divided into three sessions, I mean three tracks, and look at the all the ingredients need to build a digital transformation on integration, analytics, APIs, so on and so forth. Then second day, we listened to how the digital transformation link with government. Jason Simpson, the CTO of State of Arizona, he explained how he's planning and working on the digital transformation there, as well as how they have plan a cloud-first strategy to get into their goals and plans that they have planned. And then after that, we had a great panel discussing about the practical issues we are having, especially the misalignment in between business and technology. Then again, we had a couple of other sessions as well on DevOps, so and so forth. So today, Catherine just gave a great keynote on digital trust. I treat blockchain as a way of creating digital trust. Still, I am not getting completely what the blockchain, but she helped me to kind of understand it better. So people call we are living in a digital world, but I treat it as a digital universe. Why? So this is a Saturday morning. If I wake up in a Saturday morning, what I see is the picture in the right-hand side. And then there's no storytelling happening anymore at my place, that kids tell Alexa, tell me a story, and then Alexa tell a story. And then they don't ask from me when Abraham Lincoln born. They ask Alexa, tell me when Abraham Lincoln born. That they gave the answers. And then the picture on the top, it's basically what happened when a couple of kids joined together. Unfortunately, I have to mask the faces because I didn't have time to get permission from those parents. This is basically my daughter waiting till she start her ballet lessons. They are kind of gathered together and then watching a digital device. So that's one reason, actually an additional reason why I like ballerina as well, because I have a ballerina at home. And if you unpack your backpack, okay? So I was too lazy to unpack, so I took a picture, but it's similar to the stuff that I have inside my backpack. We will see various devices, kind of connectors, chargers, all this stuff, because we carry all these things because we need this stuff. These things has become essentials for our day-to-day life. So this picture, this took in 2012, October 26. Can you remember what happened in 2012, October 26? Okay, so the Sandy, hit the East Coast. And then this is a picture taken in New York City. While the New York City completely went blackout that day, people looking for water, food, shelter, all the primary needs, while they are doing that, they were looking for places to charge their devices. So you can see, even in a disaster situation, people try to charge their devices and then connect with that. So that is the digital universe that I am talking about, because every person are connected to these devices and they are looking for a digital experience with each and everything. So as an organization, so we can't treat digital as a second level thing, and we can't have a different strategy for digital transformation. The company strategy is the digital strategy, because otherwise we can't satisfy our clients or the stakeholders who kind of utilize these services and the products that we are providing. So before talking about the solution, let's look at the problem. What's the problem? So this is actually an example that WSO2, we were working with a customer who was trying to build a platform. And then in their platform, they built around 100 APIs, 60 message flows using the integration stuff, and then 80 services in number of data tables and databases. And they created it multi-tenanted from day one, and then they had three active tenants running in the platform, and the first release went after 3 years. So the problem is now they release this product after 3 years, then the business requirements has changed, and people who was willing to use the platform has changed, and then project didn't go through because there was a misalignment there. And the next problem is this, okay, RFPs. We see RFPs and we treat it as kind of it killed the innovation. Why it works like that, if you look at the timeline, I think it's not that clear, but if you look at the timeline, it takes a lot of time to gather the requirement, it takes a lot of time to create the requirement, create the RFP. By the time we create the RFP, again, the requirements might be not valid. And then they issue the RFP, evaluate the vendors, and then make a final decision, and start the implementation. Implementation, again, it's a set, it's a fixed set of requirements, so the implementation will happen in one project and as a one delivery. So when they deliver the project within the timeline, by considering the timeline, the requirement might be not valid as well. So this is the problem, and we see this happening again and again. That's why we thought of look at a solution for this, and then how to overcome this problem. So I took this picture to show like what will happen after kind of releasing a product after a long time period. It's kind of a ship in a desert. Like what's the purpose of having there? A homeless person might use it for shelter, but that's not the purpose of building a boat like this. Then the solution or the approach is about the iterative architecture. It's not only related to the software industry. So this is one of the great engineering projects that we have seen. It's the Hubble telescope. If you look at this is, I think, the fifth version of the Hubble telescope. And it came in a timeline like this. They created and architected in a way that they can improve it, and they start releasing different type of versions. And today, we see a very powerful product that they are running, and then still it's evolving. The main concept here, the way they architect the first version, allow them to do this incremental improvement. So the idea here is think big, act small. I think you can see the cat and the lion, hopefully. So basically, have a bigger vision, but achieve the vision in an incremental way. So that's the whole idea about this iterative approach. So to do that, we even encourage, as well as we even use this concept called the minimal viable product. If you carefully listen to Sanjeev on Monday, how we are planning Ballerina, basically, like get the minimal viable product out quickly and then keep on incrementing that. So that's the whole concept of the iterative approach. The advantage of the iterative approach is feedback. So this is how we get feedback. So it's kind of very direct and constructive feedback. So that way we can really improve. This was taken, I think, 3 years back during a conference. So you can get the feedback and keep on improving. So that's the main advantage of an iterative approach. Based on the feedback, you can improve your product and get release the next version of that. So in summary, like you plan, you build, you test, you run, and then you repeat the same steps. Basically using the available resources as well as available environment. So adjust to that and then use it and release something in an incremental way. So when we do the kind of have this approach and trying to iteratively release this stuff, there are technical things we need to consider, as well as there are a lot of non-technical things we need to consider. So that's the main thing Thomas explained during his keynote. There are a lot of non-technical problems that we have, and we need to have an iterative approach to solve these problems as well. So the first thing and the most difficult thing, Thomas said that the non-technical part is the most difficult thing, so I call it as iterative people, where how we can have an iterative approach to build that and find a solution. So to build digital products, we need a digital workforce that align with the digital objectives and the strategies that we created. And have the knowledge, so and so forth. But everybody should be aligned with the same goals and the objectives, but how it works basically based on small groups that we call as pods. It can be kind of 10, 20 maximum groups that will work on these projects. So to operate the pods, organization should be podular as well. So you need to have a culture and an operational model that small groups can work in their own silos and then deliver something by connecting to other pods. So that's the structure that we need to have to operate in this type of a mode. Then how to start? The start, we call it as a digital core or a small group that will work on the first project, because there can be gaps in the knowledge, because you might be taking new technologies to implement this stuff. It might be a new concept, so you need to bridge the knowledge gap, as well as there can be cultural gaps, because even the iterative approach, the way the project works, and how you frequently release, all these things can be new to the organization. So you need to fill that gap and create this small group called the digital core and release the first project internally. Then you can use this the primary team or the digital core that you created to bring the rest of the organization into the digital workforce. So the digital core can be the evangelist who will kind of do internal, they might write stuff, like they might blog about how they work, and then they might go and do internal presentations, so and so forth. They will do a lot of evangelizing internally to educate the other people in the organization. Then there should be a proper onboarding program, like, okay, how you start a digital project, like how you create an environment, what are the necessary stuff that you need to start the project. Most of the stuff you can automate and keep it there. So there should be a proper onboarding program there as well. And then since I explained about the technical gap as well as the cultural gap, there should be a proper training program, and most of the people from the digital core can be used as the trainers, and then you can use an approach like a train the trainer, like identify key people who can educate other people and train them first, so they will go and train the rest of the people in the organization. Then people, like, okay, they will come and sit in a training room, but to make it more effective and interesting, you can run things like hackathons, like ask them to come up with a new idea, and then write some services, expose the services as an API, and then build application. Like that, you can create some interesting projects and create hackathons and run it frequently in the organization. So that way, you can start with that particular small team and then keep on improving this thing and make the organization to a digital workforce. So this is something I picked from a previous session I did. So when you create the digital workforce, it will not work if you stick to the traditional way of treating the people. You have to engage everybody in the organization. You need to empower them, as well as you have to entrust them. Otherwise, you will not be able to take their ideas and build something new and deliver to your consumers. Then that's about the iterative people. Well, now let's look at how we can have an approach to build the software in an iterative manner. So Gartner recently identified five things actually. If we are explaining a digital enterprise or a digital transformation project, these are the things that they ask to consider. First thing is about customers or whoever who is using this product. And then things basically like devices and all this other stuff involved in that particular environment. And then the information and intelligence or insight about this stuff and different ecosystems. So those are the very high level stuff they have identified how you can build the digital enterprise. Then they introduced this concept as well for the architect to use to look at the digital enterprise and then have an environment to build these innovative ideas. They use these three layers called system of record, that the stuff that exists already, and then system of differentiation, that's where like you go and build stuff better than other, better than your competition, and then top of that you have the system of innovation, that environment that you can build new stuff. So we kind of look at it in a little different way, but the same concept, but more kind of a practical manner. So when you look at innovation platform at a business level, we look at like what are the current IT infrastructure, what exists, databases, applications, then infrastructure, what exists currently, and then what are the future IT strategies that you are planning to do, like if you are planning to bring containers, if you are going with the cloud strategy, and if you are moving from relational database to NoSQL, all these new IT strategies need to be considered. And top of that, you need to identify the internal consumers, because this is a new concept with the digital transformation, that there are internal consumers for your applications. It will be not the end application, it might be the APIs or the services, so you need to consider them, otherwise you can't share these different type of capabilities that you are building in different pods that we talked earlier. And then the external consumers, that it can be an end user who's using your application, or it can be a partner that will be utilizing your capabilities. So you need to consider them, identify them, as well as identify their behavior as well. That's where I think the feedback is very important. So when you get the feedback, you can properly identify your external consumers and their behavior. Then let's move to a reference architecture of enterprise architecture. This is a typical enterprise architecture, how architects kind of use this the business architecture into a technical architecture. So these are like four or five different layers that people use. You get a system of automation about how you automate the stuff, and then how you use infrastructure related things, and then source system of record contains all the information that you store, like actual databases, file systems, and then it can be NoSQL storage, and then top of that you will get all the system of record, that basically how you access the data and then manipulate the data, expose the data, and provide a way to access these data sets. And system of integration, that's basically the layer that kind of create the services, expose the services as APIs, security, governance, all these things come at that layer. And top of that, you get the system of engagement, that's where the end-use applications will come and have access to these applications. So why I use this diagram to explain how you can have an iterative approach, because this can be the end architecture of your enterprise. So we need to have an iterative approach to build that and then come to that level. So there are two approaches that I am going to explain. So first thing is, so this is kind of a runtime view of the previous diagram, like even you have this stuff, when you run it, it will look like this. You will have all these kind of different type of components running inside that particular layered architecture diagram. So the two approaches that I'm going to explain, first thing is called a vertically iterative way. So this is actually a best fit for a small to medium enterprise that will have limited number of requirements. That in most of the enterprises, the source system of record and system of record layers already exist. So what you can do kind of quickly, if you want to issue a develop a quick an application quickly, you can develop the application and have a direct access to the data set and release it. Then you can slowly bring the integration layer and improve your application after that. And then if you can bring the automation in the next level. So as I explained, this is not a good fit for the larger enterprises. Small to medium enterprises can have a approach like this. And I'm not recommending this approach as well, but in some cases you might have to use it, depend on the constraints that you have. So this is the recommended approach, that you will have all the layers, and then with the time and the requirement, look at the priorities and improve each and every layer with the timeline. So that is what we see with most of the enterprises. They will have all the layers with a kind of an MVP model, that they will have the minimal viable product, and that will satisfy the requirements that they are looking at in a given time. So they will improve it with the time. Then we talk about innovation platform and how you get there, basically. So that's what I'm trying to explain here. What you can do and what we found with most of the customers, a practical way, start with the project. Don't start with the platform, because we have seen like a kind of failure projects. You build a platform by assuming these are the requirements and functionality that you need to provide for your customers, but that's not the reality. When you release the platform, nobody will use it. To make it more practical, this approach is very helpful. You create a project, a useful, innovative idea that your end users will use. So start with the project, move the project into a platform by identifying the common features. So you will get the platform and the project that the first project will run on top of the platform after the first iteration. And then you can improve it like this. So what will happen, the platform will grow, and then new projects will come and utilize the platform. When new projects are coming, you need to add more and more features to the platform level as well. So both layers will grow in that way. The key thing is you might have to, or I think you need to maintain a version for the platform, and you need to maintain versions for the projects as well. And sometimes you have to run multiple versions of the platform, because not every project can migrate to a new platform. So actually, we are releasing a white paper on this subject as well, that kind of detailedly explaining how you manage these two layers, projects and platforms, and have a consistent way of improving both layers. Then one success story about one of the customers. So they are using the this concept clearly. So they have a platform and project separation. Addition to that, they have a platform team who will look at the platform needs and then improve it. So there's a kind of a platform owner from the business side, and there's an enterprise architect, and there's a kind of a platform specialist working on that, and there's a test automation engineer who kind of automating everything, and then operational and DevOps people working on the platform level. Then each and every project, there's a project manager, and there's a business architect who kind of identify the requirements, and a project team working on the implementation side. So this model working perfectly for them, since there's a clear separation, but there's a good synergy in between those two teams, so they maintain platform versions and they are moving with the projects by releasing in frequent timeframes. So in summary, on the iterative people where, so what we see, like you create projects, you go into the next iteration, take the feedback, basically plan, build, release, and run, and continuously improve your releases and the application that you're releasing in this process. Then the tools, like you need to have a set of tools to do and practice this iterative approach. The most common as well as the recommended tool is kind of a Scrum approach, because it's a really simple way of defining these things and have a proper plan as well as proper control and governance in your project. So it works for small projects as well as it works for larger enterprise level projects as well. But sometimes depend on your organization policies and then different type of requirements, you might have to have a proper architecture approach to do this. Then you can use some of the methods. That this is one framework, that scale agile framework. It define a proper architecture approach to be iterative and have a proper iterative process. Some of the organizations using this as well. And there's another framework called TOGAF that again done by the Open Group of Architecture Forum. So they have an iterative approach for that particular architecture model as well. So I'm not kind of recommending these two, because these are kind of very complicated, but if you have to meet some set of standards as well as if you need to comply with some set of policies, then you can take a look at it. Those supports the iterative architecture. So you can pick tools from these type of standard places, but you need to create your own tools as well, because most of the things are depend on how you operate and what are your business goals, so and so forth. So if you listen to the talk done by Motorola on Monday, they discuss about a zero-touch automation framework that they have done. They have automated everything. When an integration engineer commits something to their Git repo, that it will start, the continuous integration will start and take the stuff from by running the test automation framework and then into the production servers. So that is one example. And then yesterday, if you listen to Randy Salton, who's the principal architect at BNY Mellon, he did a detailed demonstration of the tools that they had built. So this is a screenshot of his tool. One of the tools, he has built multiple tools. One tool is basically how you can convert a SOAP service into a REST service. So when you point to a WSDL, it will read the WSDL document and then look at the operations and bindings in the WSDL document, and it will convert them into REST resources and list everything. So if you are happy with the default configuration, you can go ahead with that. If not, you can edit it. So this kind of increasing the productivity of the developers and the integration engineers, you can quickly convert one SOAP service into REST service. There are multiple tools that they have built. And if you talk to the customers, they will explain on different type of tools that they have built. You need these type of tools, one to be iterative, one and then second to be rapid application development. Otherwise, you will spend a lot of time to repeatable tasks like this. So you need to build your own tools based on your requirements. Then the next thing is, traditionally, when we are doing cool things in our labs and in our development environment, most of the people in the organization, they don't know. But with the digital approach, there's a connectivity in between business and the technical groups. So we need to have these type of things built to create awareness, access, and the transparency. So basically, things like dashboards of analytics, basically, and analytical dashboards about what's really happening in your environment, like how many API calls came, how many services are running, and then what type of transactions happen, so on and so forth. And then again, the next area is you should have proper stores, like API stores, app stores, that will advertise the things that you are doing. So if anybody is interested to access the API, they can come to the API store, subscribe, get a key, and access it. And you might build a lot of applications on by utilizing the APIs, so you should have a app store to advertise these apps, because in traditional way, people who know about the URL, they can access the application, but things has changed. We can kind of promote and advertise the cool things that we are doing. So this is one example of the internal app store that we are using. All the apps that we use internally list in this app store, and we access it. Based on the permissions, it lists what you can access and not. So this is another important fact when you are building tools around your digital transformation journey. Then the iterative middleware, like how middleware fit into the iterative approach, and some good practices that you can adopt from that. So the first thing is, since you are providing this innovative platform, you should have rich functional capabilities. That's why even we have identified these five areas, like API management, integration, security, analytics, and Internet of Things, IoT, that cover all the kind of basic functionality that you need to build an enterprise and then enhance it. So you should have these type of capabilities provided by your digital enterprise. And then this is something Sanjeeva used to tell, become recomposable. So to become recomposable, what you should do, like have an API everywhere type of a concept. If you look at this diagram, I took this diagram from the session Nuan Bandara, who's a solutions architect, did in the API track. So basically, if you look at each and every layer, expose that functionality as an API to the outside world, so you can take those things and build new stuff frequently and release. Then this is, so as part of my job, I had to visit customers. So this is Devaka Randhania, VP of Sales. This is just opposite United Airlines, I think a few minutes before we convinced Suresh, I think somewhere here. So when we go to customers, we have different type of discussions. So sometimes customers tell, OK, I have this integration product X, and is it possible to use your identity server? Then my answer usually, yes, of course, we have the market best integration product. But by the way, you can use the identity product with your integration product as well. Then sometimes customers tell, OK, I have an identity product X. Can I use your API manager? Then again, I answer, yes, you can do that. No issue. We have the best identity product. And I add little more to that. I tell, OK, we have the best identity product as well as best identity security architect in the organization. Then they ask who. Then I tell, OK, Prabhat Sirivardhana. People, if they know about Prabhat, then I tell, did you read the book? Then if they don't know Prabhat, then I ask, again, did you read the book? Then they ask, what book or which book? Then I tell, OK, yeah, advanced API security book. Then I think from the architect, the sales person coming out, at least I can sell a book if they don't buy the identity product. And once they read the book, they will identify the product capabilities, so and so forth. I asked from Prabhat the commission, but still it's not happening. OK, so what I want to tell in that story about the open interoperability, that our products were like seamlessly work with each other, as well as they work with other vendor products as well. It can be having a traditional, it can be having a modern API, we can easily connect. And if it is kind of not a proper API, we can even connect to a low-level database level thing or a file and connect without an issue. Why this is important? Because you, from day one, you can't start everything from scratch. You need to work with the stuff that already exists in your data centers. So this is very important, the open interoperability. So that way you can connect to the existing stuff and build your new things. So this will get the functionality will get improved a lot with Ballerina, because we are kind of having a proper way of connecting to the standard stuff without an issue. Then the next thing is about the technologies, like you need to consider about the container nativeness, microservices, then serverless technologies, and continuous integration testing, so and so forth. So the middleware should provide, and middleware should be compatible with these things for you to be more agile and iterative. Then the decentralized, because we talk about the pods and how things operate in silos. So to do that, centralized will not work for everything. As an example, I call this as platform of platforms. You might even need to deploy the platform in multiple places, because sometimes people will not come and use the central deployment. But things like security, user stores, and continuous integration, continuous delivery, those type of things can be centralized and managed. So this is a different approach to the traditional way of we are treating it. So you need to look at a decentralized approach sometimes to make these things practical. Then the open source, I think a lot of speakers talk about this thing. So I will just highlight the advantage. It's about freedom. It's about the ownership. You own the stuff that you do, and then trust and the community, because there's a huge community behind the open source thing. And then investment-wise also, different between CapEx and OpEx, you will have an advantage as well. So I'm not going to talk about it in detail. Then we kind of talk about iterative approach. So I thought of lead by example. This is how this slide deck created. This is 2 weeks before the conference, and this is kind of a week before the conference, and then this is last night. Okay, so it's kind of an iterative approach how I build. Don't consider the progress bar. It's kind of 10 slides, 20 slides, and then around 47 slides last night. Because end of the party, a lot of people, when they walk out from the place, they said, okay, I'm looking forward for your presentation. So the panic monster hit hardly, and then I started creating this thing. But yes, this is an iterative approach to build something, and then. So iterative approach, there's a danger, because you need to identify the iteration properly. Otherwise, you will not achieve the end goal. So you need to consider the business requirements and then identify this set of features are the most important stuff, and then package it and deliver. Otherwise, there's a danger. So identifying the first MVP as well as plan the each and every iteration is an important factor as well. So this is we are coming to the end, and so we kind of created the theme for the conference is agile digital transformation through open source. So our objective, kind of individually, you to the person who will lead the digital transformation, if you are in a lead technical role, and if not, like, you will be part of the digital transformation journey of your organization. That's one objective we had. And then your organization to be a digital enterprise. So we don't want to you to be in this situation. I think this example we took in previous keynotes as well. What he said, basically, we didn't do anything wrong, but something somehow we lost. What happened basically, even if you are in an iterative manner, I think Sanjeeva did explain this as well, you have to improve, and then when you come to the peak, you have to kind of do a proper jump and then be innovative. Otherwise, you will fail. This is one quote from the guy Kawasaki. He has a nice 10 points to be improve and then jump to the next curve of this innovation track. He's explaining jump to the next curve. So we did the next curve jump on Monday, kind of releasing Ballerina. And then we don't want to jump alone, like we need to jump with you. So the idea here, kind of download it, use it, and then contribute it. And we can help you to jump to your next curve as well with the technology advantages that we are providing with this new technology. So as I said, we don't need to jump alone. We need to be a technology partner, not like a typical vendor. So that's where like we position our middleware stack as open technology for agile digital business. So that's about it. And I hope you enjoy the session. And thank you.